This Sunday on Close Up, we sit down with Governor Maggie Hassan, and from budgets that aren't to the heroin problem, there's plenty to get to this morning. Also, another governor, but this one wants to be president, Chris Christie, give us his take on issues ranging from nukes in Iran to political correctness. Morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Josh McKelvin. So much for a quiet summer for Governor Hassan, from a budget veto that has led to a stare down in Concord to a very real drug epidemic that has even led to some finger pointing. Governor Hassan, very busy these days, but she did take time out to be my guest this morning. I appreciate it.
Good
to see you, ma'am. Yeah, a lot to get to this morning, but let's start with the bias-free language guide, which swift reaction from your office and UNH, I'll point out. Kudos to Mark Huddleston. But this, when you read this, were you like, all right, we're going too far now with political correctness?
I am very proud to call myself an American. Americans also respect free speech while trying to respect each other in a democracy where everybody counts. But I did think that the guide was over the top, and I'm glad UNH took it down.
Yeah, it's gone. All right, back to, let's talk about the budget. Last week you put out a compromise, another plan, which you had hoped that Republicans compromise. Where do things stand right now? Because it doesn't appear like any progress is being made.
Well, as you know, last week I put out a compromise that really addressed what Republicans had told me was their number one priority, business tax cuts. We proposed that we would make those tax cuts more quickly than the Republicans had proposed, and that we would do it in a way that paid for those cuts so that we could also continue to invest in the priorities that businesses throughout New Hampshire tell me are so important to them, workforce development, modern and safe transportation infrastructure, healthy and safe communities, so really tackling this substance abuse challenge as we are, but you know, going at it even harder, and making sure that we can do things like the compromise proposes putting more money into our substance abuse fight right now. It also would allow us to reduce tuition at the community colleges, so critical for workforce development in the state. So that proposal was really an effort to say, look, I'm willing to compromise, the Democrats are willing to compromise on your biggest priority. I've had an encouraging meeting with leadership this week and want very much to hear from them a counterproposal. And, you know, that's the way we're going to get together and solve this budget and have a budget
sure.
that really supports the people and businesses of New Hampshire.
And of course, you never want to negotiate in public when this kind of thing is going on there. But when you say that you're encouraged by some meetings that you've had, is there movement? Are you getting closer, do you believe, to coming up with a budget?
Well, I still think it's going to be really important for especially Republican legislators to come back to Concord mm-hmm. and really consider my proposal and counterpropose something. That's the way negotiations work. But I know that we can do it. I know that we, 2 years ago, did a bipartisan budget. The people of this state solve problems in their everyday lives all the time, and that's the least they can expect of us. And meanwhile, we've got some pressing challenges, such as the substance abuse crisis, that really does require that we all come together and find our way forward. And so I continue to urge the leadership to come back to the table. As I said, we had an encouraging conversation, but we do need to get a counterproposal so we can really get this negotiation moving.
Talking about the budget abuse or the heroin crisis, basically, you have a police chief in Manchester who says, you know what, we've been crying for help and nobody seems to be listening in Concord. And he's not talking about your office. He's saying there's a lot of leaders up there. Where we are now, do you feel like that New Hampshire should have been doing things better? And I'm not asking you to finger point towards your drug czar or anything like that. We'll get to that in a moment. But hindsight being what it is, has the state done enough?
Substance abuse and the challenge it brings, both in terms of the addiction and illness that it causes, but also the crime that it causes, is our most pressing public health and safety challenge, right? And one of the reasons I worked so hard to bring Medicaid expansion to the state of New Hampshire is because we were seeing the data, we were hearing from families, from businesses, we were seeing more and more overdoses and sadly overdose deaths in New Hampshire. And so we brought Medicaid expansion to the state in part because that brings tens of millions of dollars that helps us stand up more treatment around the state. We have been working with, talking with law enforcement, especially through the Association of Chiefs of Police, since I became governor. And as different police chiefs have said throughout the state, they were very clear that we can't arrest our way out of this problem. And so they really asked us to focus on prevention and education and treatment. That's what the Director of Substance Abuse and Recovery and Behavioral Health is working on doing. He issued 22 statements, action steps,
recommendations
last week, and we'll continue to work on not only implementing those as quickly and effectively as we can, but developing those metrics for success. And meanwhile, we've taken some emergency actions, like making Narcan more available, making it more available to our first responders, our law enforcement, and now to families or people who are living with folks who are suffering from addiction, so that we can try to save lives, as we're also trying to address the long-term problem that substance abuse is. It took us a long time to get here. We need to work as effectively as we can to stem this tide, but it's going to take us all working together, and it's going to take us committing to each other that we won't play politics with this.
There are a lot of people who think that in order to coordinate the state's response, so that the heroin problem is so large, it's going to take someone to really get in there and kick, you know what I'm saying. And after the fiscal committee funded the position for Jack Wozniak and the drug czar, there wasn't a whole lot of confidence in the man himself. Seems like a very nice guy, but I'm asking you, are you convinced that he is the right guy to coordinate this effort, which many feel is a crisis because people are dying daily?
Well, one of the reasons the job was created was the other concern and questions we heard from law enforcement, from treatment providers, from the Governor's Commission on Alcohol and Drug Prevention, Treatment, and Recovery. They noted that there's lots of effort in New Hampshire, but there was no single person or office that was coordinating that effort and trying to streamline it, integrate it, and make it as effective as it can possibly be. In Jack Wozniak's first 100 days on the job, he talked to dozens and dozens of people, focusing on what law enforcement had indicated they wanted us to focus on, which is the treatment and recovery side of this, and came up with these 22 action steps, including, for instance, let's get a drug court going in Manchester as soon as we can, including making sure that we're standing up more and more treatment. While we need to make sure that we are implementing those steps and make sure that we have metrics that will help us measure our success, including measuring Jack's success, we also shouldn't lose sight of the fact that the single most important thing we can do right now to address the treatment side of this is to reauthorize Medicaid expansion. What people might not know is that our current bipartisan Medicaid expansion program is due to sunset in January of 2017. Mm-hmm. And the problem with that for treatment providers is Medicaid expansion was the first time that we brought in federal dollars for treatment of substance abuse. And right now, as we're trying to expand the capacity in the state, which is a real challenge for all of us, treatment providers are holding back because they don't know if the program's going to be reauthorized, so if the money's going to be there to pay them for their services. So while we are all talking about substance abuse, we've got a legislature that has refused to reauthorize it. I took reauthorization of Medicaid expansion out of my budget compromise proposal because the legislature told me they really didn't want to put it in the budget. But the most important thing we could do to get more treatment for our people in the middle of this crisis is to reauthorize Medicaid expansion. And I'm hoping very much that the legislature will come back as soon as they can, and so we can address this separately. One of the things I did put in my budget proposal, my compromise proposal, was the funds we would need to reauthorize Medicaid expansion should we decide to do it, so that they will be there and everybody will have confidence that the money is there to reauthorize it. But I also provided a small amount of funding for the kind of data collection and information sharing that the legislature has been asking for, so that we can answer their questions about Medicaid expansion, but really get to the reauthorization so we can stand up treatment across the state of New Hampshire, which is our single biggest challenge.
And a lot of people hopeful that people get in a room and figure this out. Let me ask you about something else that's been in the news a lot lately, and that's the videos associated with Planned Parenthood as the funding issue comes up there. First, your thoughts about what those videos revealed.
Planned Parenthood provides critical health services for women, preventive and primary health care, cancer screenings, and they need to continue to do that work. The voluntary tissue donation that was an issue in those videos doesn't happen in Planned Parenthood of Northern New England in New Hampshire.
Are you certain of that? I mean, have you looked into it? Are you planning to look into it, investigate?
Well,
some governors are.
Well, certainly Planned Parenthood of Northern New England has not engaged in that. Planned Parenthood itself has apologized for the tone that some of its employees took, but this is about a group of people who have been determined to stop women from having access to the kind of health care that they need to stop women from having the kind of independence that they should have in making their own health care decisions. This is a group that infiltrated Planned Parenthood, took secret videos, and it's really a distraction from the fact that Planned Parenthood has been under attack, as has the right of women to make their own health care decisions. I'll always stand up for the right of women to make their own health care decisions. It's critical not only to their rights as human beings, but also to their capacity to chart their own course in their lives and succeed economically, and for their families to succeed economically. Granite Staters should know that public money does not pay for elective abortion, and they should know that in New Hampshire, we don't have voluntary tissue donation through Planned Parenthood. But I'd also ask people to think about the fact that the reason that some patients decide they want to voluntarily donate tissue is because the research that we can do is life-saving, life-changing. This is research that in some cases may help people walk again, in some cases may cure terrible, devastating neurological disease. And so I think it's really important not to let this video be a distraction from the attack on Planned Parenthood and the rights of women that they protect and the health care for women that they protect.
And we have less than a minute. I want to ask you, you've said that you won't make any decisions about your political future until the budget is settled, but are you feeling the pressure to either rule out a Senate run, as many have speculated that you're considering, or say that you're going to run for governor again because the clock is ticking and other people could be waiting to get in this race?
I'm focused every day on making sure that we can find our way forward on a compromise budget that will serve the businesses and people of New Hampshire, paying for those business tax cuts while addressing the economic priorities that we need for us to be successful, avoiding that big hole in the budget that the budget I vetoed would cause, and on combating the substance abuse crisis. I have no timeline for decisions about 2016.
Governor, thanks so much for your time this morning. I know it's been busy. I appreciate you coming in.
Thank you very much.
Good to see you.